coming to you from Forager Brewery in Rochester, our town.
Welcome to our town. I'm Jennifer Koski. Ardell Brede has been mayor of Rochester since 2003. He joins me today to talk about the state of the city. Welcome, Mayor.
Well, it's great to be with you, Jen.
Oh, I'm so happy to have you on. So, 2003.
It's a while ago.
It's a while ago. Tell me, what you must have seen incredible changes in the last, 13 years?
Yeah, one of the big ones, I think, is the continual growth that we have in Rochester. I think if you go from the 2000 census to the 2010, we grew, it was 21,000 people.
It's incredible.
And by now, it's over 25,000 people.
Right.
I always say there's probably just a handful of cities in Minnesota that even have that much population. And
right.
We've had that growth.
Right.
And it's been all, you know, really well managed by, you know, obviously the city. And Mayo has been, of course, the big driver in much of that. But it's been great. And the people that are here are wonderful. That makes this such a great city.
Yes, I will attest to that. You know, I, my husband and I moved here in 96, and I think the population at the time was 68,000 people. Does that sound right?
It could be, yeah.
It's incredible what has happened. Now, what are some of the major, like when you look back on the last 13 years, what are some of the milestones that come to mind?
Well, of course, one of the things that's more recent has been the Destination Medical Center, the DMC, which is really, as someone pointed out, though, but if you go back a full decade or two, we've had that kind of growth, and
right.
a lot of things have happened. But I think, again, the really valuing the arts in Rochester.
Right.
I know the first time I called a number of the arts groups together, and when they were leaving the room, one of the ladies said to another one, "We've never all been in the same room together before."
Really?
And that really kind of triggered it, that said, they are so important in any
right.
community that we really need to promote that. And so I've been honored, I think unjustly, to be kind of a champion for the arts in Rochester.
Right.
But there's so much going on with the
right.
arts itself. And sometimes we take that for granted. I think
right.
it just builds such a great feeling for a community to have that. And of course, we've got people that are just experts in
right.
that as well.
So you're seeing more collaboration in the arts groups?
Very much so. And at times too, you know, one of the old phrases is sometimes it's like herding cats.
But yeah.
Because they're all wanting a piece of the pie.
And, right.
It's tough because the arts don't get funded like they should be.
Right. Although I think we do a pretty good job in Minnesota.
We do. But it is tough. And of course, those that are starting out, they're kind of at the bottom end.
Yes.
And they're looking for more money and
yes.
and getting sponsorship or, you know, donors that help with that, being patrons of the arts. And so, but it's exciting. And
right.
When I was president of the League of Minnesota Cities, I said my focus that year was going to be on the arts, and they kind of looked at me like, what? What? And as I started to explain it to a couple staff people, before I had much to say, they started pointing out, oh yeah, we've got this, we've got that, I can see
right.
that. And it's not only Rochester, but it's all around us. And Chatfield is great for that as well, and
right.
others. So, but that's been, it's been a joy to be able to do that.
So what do you think, when you said the arts and they were surprised, what do you think they had expected you to focus on?
Well, at that time, you know, it was, and it still is, you know, being green,
yes.
energy, all of that, which is all mm-hmm. important. They are.
Right.
But, and I thought about those, and then I'd come back and I'd say, we got to do that. And
right.
I remember asking the board then with the League of Cities, and I said, each month when we get together, one of you was going to tell me what the arts are in your community.
Yeah. Right.
I remember one of the mayors said, he was a mayor because it's not all mayors on that, but he said too, I didn't think we were had much going on, but he says, and then I found out I'm more artsy than I thought, he said. And but I said, we all have festivals and things
yes.
like that that really
yes.
make our lives and our communities
right.
come alive.
Right. And in Rochester with the Art Center,
uh-huh.
with a beautiful Art Center, we have some beautiful theaters. There are a lot of offerings
oh,
here.
Oh, yes. Yep.
Yeah.
And we have a civic music department in
yes.
the city, which is rare that most cities don't.
Right.
And we do that, and of course, summertime that we'll be experiencing, and down by the riverside
yes.
and all of those.
Right.
25th year that we've been doing
right.
that.
You know, years ago, I don't hear it so much anymore, but there used to be people in town who would say, oh, you know, there's nothing to do
right
here. There is no excuse for that anymore, is
well,
there?
Well, there's no excuse, and you don't hear it as much anymore. What's happening with the downtown and everything around it, you used to hear that a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I rarely hear that anymore. If you're saying that, you haven't gotten off your rear end to get out and see.
Right, like my grandma said, only boring people get bored, right? So
that's probably good. I'll remember that one.
Yeah. No, there are, there's more often times that I have more things to do on an evening than nothing to do.
Well, I always say, anybody want to follow me for a day or two and I'll show you. There's more than I can get to. So, and it's not all arts, but it's important things for this community.
Okay, well, thank you so much, Mayor. Our Town is brought to you in part by the following amazing people and organizations.
Clements Subaru proudly partners with award-winning KSMQ Public Television. Clements Subaru of Rochester. Clements' clear value promise is to make buying a car fast, fair, and simple. The University of Minnesota Rochester, an undergraduate health sciences university offering education designed to change tomorrow's healthcare. University of Minnesota Rochester, always in the heart of our community. The Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund and the citizens of Minnesota.
And the members of KSMQ Public Television. Thank you.
And great conversation with Mayor Brede. Coming up later in the program, we learn about the migrating erogenous zones in women's fashion during the 19th century. And we tour Rochester's walking subway system. We've all been there probably at one time or another. And today's Our Town Big Question. The Canada Goose. Is this cherished city symbol the most annoying bird in town or lovely? You decide. But up next, Stephen Schmidt gives us a look at the wide variety of musical options sponsored by the City of Rochester in Our Town Culture.
Okay, here we go. Are we rolling?
Mm-hmm.
My name is Stephen Schmidt. My day job is General Manager of the City of Rochester Music Department, also known as Riverside Concerts. I'm also a singer-songwriter from right here in Rochester, Minnesota. You know, this is going to be a very cool summer for us this year because Riverside Concerts will be celebrating the 25th anniversary of the Down by the Riverside Concerts series. The concerts begin on Sunday, July 10th, and they happen every Sunday until the 21st of August. The shows begin at 7, and they begin primarily with a local opening act for some headliner. And we've got some really cool entertainment lined up for this summer. Riverside Concerts also partners with the Rochester Downtown Alliance to program the music festival portion of Thursdays on 1st and 3rd. So every Thursday in June, July, and August, we do two acts per stage, and there are two stages. The first show begins at 5 o'clock on each stage, and the second show begins at 7 o'clock. We'll have artists from all over the country coming to perform Thursdays on 1st and 3rd, as well as artists from here in Rochester, throughout the 11-county southeastern Minnesota region, and from across the state. There's sure to be music for every musical taste. One of the really interesting things that we do with Thursdays on 1st and 3rd is a series of world music concerts. And we're happy to partner with the Paramount Theater in Austin, Minnesota, who hosts some of the outreach concerts that we do in conjunction with that series. I mean, this year we'll have a wonderful artist called the Karar Collective, and they play a really interesting Afro-pop music from Ethiopia. This summer we'll also have as part of the World Music Concert Series a real interesting group from Wales. Now, we've presented Celtic music in the past, but Welsh music is really different from Celtic music, so not only will you get a chance to see them perform at the Paramount Theatre in Austin, but you'll get a chance to see them as part of Thursdays on 1st and 3rd. The entire time I've been working as an arts administrator, I've never stopped working as a musician. As a singer, songwriter, and recording artist, I've been doing all of that for well over 40 years, and my new project, Heartland, has been something that's been really interesting to do. I mean, what's really interesting about this particular album is that it's sort of divided in thirds. A third of it is full band arrangements of songs that I've written. A third of it is acoustic trio versions of songs that I've written. And another third of it is more of the solo type work that I've been doing at house concerts and standing rooms, festivals, that type of thing.
Town. It's all about you, Rochester. Send us a picture of your favorite feature of Rochester. Rochester@ksmq.org.
Here are some facts and pseudo facts about Rochester. The city appears on several rankings of the best places to live. You've heard these repeated like a mantra. Number 6, best place to live. Number 6, most affordable city for home buyers. Number 8, best place for a long life. Here's one we like. Number 3, least stressful place in the U.S. Is that because Rochester also has 10 golf courses? And tee up this fact. Both Golf Digest and Golf for Women have ranked Rochester as the 5th best golf market in the Midwest. Here's an odd one. If you commute to Rochester from Preston, Austin, or Cannon Falls, it can easily take you an hour to get to work, once you park and stop off for a double mochaccino. But for people who live in Rochester, the average commute time is still 15 minutes, without the mochaccino. From the website of City Council member Mike Wojcik, who cites census data, 40,000 workers commute to work in Rochester from around southeast Minnesota. We took a look at a list of the largest employers in Rochester. The top 4 include the usual suspects, Mayo, IBM, Rochester Public Schools, Olmsted Medical. The 5th largest employer might surprise you. It's Olmsted County. The 9th largest employer is Crenlow, which makes, among other things, cabs for construction vehicles. We did Google searches to compare Crenlow with J-Lo. You know, the popular singer and actress? J-Lo won handily, with 31 million more results than Crenlow's 30,000 results. Back in the great outdoors, Rochester has 37 soccer fields and more than 50 tennis courts. Feel like hitting the beach? Rochester has 19 sand volleyball courts. If you want to go further afield, Minnesota has only one state forest south of the Twin Cities. That would be the Richard J. Dorrer Memorial Hardwood State Forest. It covers much of this corner of Minnesota between Rochester and the Mississippi River, mere minutes away, less time than some of us spend on our daily commutes. That's it for our town rundown. Now, let's go on a walkabout in the subway system. Most people think of trains or light rail when they think of a subway system. In Rochester, it's powered by your feet.
Hi guys, I'm here with Matthew Dacey, the Museum Director of Mayo Clinic. How's it going?
Great, and thank you for coming to the Mayo Clinic subway today. There are more than 6 miles of these underground halls that we call subways. Mm-hmm. They link up our principal buildings, so you can walk from building to building for your appointments, for your activities, and never have to go outside. In Minnesota, that's a good thing to do.
For sure. So Matt, tell me what we're looking at.
Mayo has long believed that art plays a key role in the healing process. We have a very extensive art collection of artists well known from around the world, and we have the works of art here as a comfort and inspiration to our patients. So what we're seeing here now is a series of endangered species by Andy Warhol, a very well-known artist. But you see, it's quite close to us. People can walk by all throughout the day, just get that energy, that inspiration from what good art can provide. This was a gift of one of our patients.
So Matt, what are we looking at? What art piece is this?
Jennifer, we honor our past here at Mayo Clinic, and what you're seeing here is a fountain salvaged from the first Mayo Clinic building, which opened in 1914 and kept here as a historical display. Many works of art here in the Mayo subway. This work of art is called Moment. It's a sculpture of an Atlantic salmon escaping a hook. The artist, Gordon Gunn, who created this, is blind. I'm sure you know the sculpture called The Thinker. This is done by the same artist, Auguste Rodin. It's called Jean d'Air, part of a larger study of work that was given to us by one of our patients. And you see in this man's face great determination against adversity.
Thank you, Matthew Dacey, for having us here. And I'm Jennifer Rogers with the Our Town Walkabout.
Michael Tenney, Wildlife Manager for the Minnesota DNR, is here with Eric and me. We're hanging out in Forager's Library, and we're getting ready to tackle today's big question. The Canada Goose, cherished city symbol or annoying park menace? Back in a moment.
Changing women's fashions. As we know, fashion trends change regularly. Back in the 1800s, women, wealthy women at least, didn't just throw on jeans and a t-shirt and call it good. They had to dress up, partly to show off their husband's wealth. The History Center of Olmsted County recently featured a photo exhibit called The Changing Erotic Zones, 150 Years of Women's Gowns. Sometimes fashion emphasized the ankle, sometimes it was the bosom, sometimes it was the knee, and sometimes it was the waist. One of the notable examples is from the 1850s, when the waist was considered the most erotic zone. The following trend swept backward, and the front of the skirt was very narrow, and the emphasis then was on the buttocks. In the 20s, the line becomes very boyish in stark contrast to the preceding era favoring the hourglass shape. By the end of the Second World War, women continued to enjoy the trousers they had become accustomed to for comfort and safety when working in factories. According to curator Colleen Gao, as women's personal freedoms expanded, the freedom to choose clothing evolved as well. Today's fashion allows women to be whomever they decide to be.
Welcome back to Our Town. I'm Eric Olson along with Jen Koski. Now, the Canada Goose is not just some random selection for a city symbol. No, no, a deep and long history. In the mid-20th century, the bird was thought to be extinct. But then in 1962, a flock in Rochester provided the foundation for its recovery.
Now a familiar and widespread bird across much of the nation, Rochester is home to a year-round population that sometimes raises the ire of local residents. Michael Tenney from the Minnesota Department of Natural Resources is here today to help us answer our big question.
A big question.
Welcome, Mike.
Well, welcome. Thank you.
So it's a love-hate relationship, is that right? There's no sitting on the fence with the geese in
Rochester.
That
seems to be the case with Canada geese in Rochester, right? Either you love them or you don't like what they leave behind on the bike path, that sort of thing. So there's not a whole lot of in between with that.
But there is, as we mentioned, a real history to them coming back to the city.
There really is, right. And you started that in your introduction by saying that in the mid-60s, in 1962 actually, the giant Canada goose, which was thought to be extinct, was rediscovered in the Rochester area by wildlife biologists that were doing routine capture and banding work with Canada geese, and just realized that the birds that they were catching in the Rochester area were quite large. In fact, they thought their scales were faulty. They tested their scales and found out that no, they were accurate. And birds that they were catching 12, 13 pounds were unheard of for Canada geese, and they matched size and weight documents for what the giant Canada goose is. And so they they rediscovered it, correct.
So at the time, at this population of geese they found, were they finding just a few geese, or was Rochester already home to a large number of geese?
Well, at that time it was a small number, 500 birds maybe. Hmm. But they were still wild, free-flying birds attracted to the Rochester area because of Charles Mayo at the time had a captive flock out by where that mansion still is today.
Right.
And that captive flock that he was feeding during the wintertime actually attracted migrants. And they just happened to attract what was left of the giant Canada goose. And
wow.
through different things that happened in the Rochester area, the dam that was constructed on Silver Lake, the power plant that kept water warm in Silver Lake all winter long, and before you knew it, more and more birds were coming into this area and doing well because of the protection they had here.
Right.
In the modern day, what's your relationship with the DNR and the Canada goose? Is there any kind of official bird counts or mitigation?
Right. We don't do counts as much as we used to in the past. Starting in the 70s, goose counts and goose work was really important and a large part of what we did here in the Rochester area. Not quite so much anymore, but we still do weekly to bi-weekly kind of counts just to get an idea of how many birds are here, when they're moving through, and that sort of thing. It's important to people in the area too. There's quite a tradition of goose hunting in the Rochester area, so people like to know what's here, and we get calls quite often from hunters and guide services as to what's happening with the goose flock. So.
Now, I know there has been an effort to minimize the population in Rochester. You know, what created that effort, and where are you with it now?
Right, and it's important to think about what's really going on here with Canada geese. You mentioned in the introduction that there's a large resident population, but there really isn't relative to what is here in the fall and in the winter.
Mm-hmm.
We think there are anywhere from 500 to maybe 1,200 local breeding birds in the Rochester area, which isn't that many. Some of those, of course, hang out at Silver Lake, and there might be 100 there at any one time in the summertime. But especially stormwater ponds in and around the city of Rochester, the flood control impoundments, places where there's permanent water, geese are going to find those areas and breed. And then, of course, we have a group of molt migrants, which are young non-breeding birds. Canada geese don't normally breed successfully until they're 3-4 years old. So between the time they're hatched and the time that they're actually raising young, they're teenagers, and they go all over the continent, basically. And sometimes will fly into the Rochester area, molt their flight feathers, so they're flightless for a while in the
mm-hmm.
summer. And there could be a few thousand birds in that category that come in just to molt their,
wow.
their feathers. And then, of course, in the fall, as birds are migrating south through their wintering areas, we get a large number of birds at that time. And we can have anywhere to up to 100,000 birds move through the Rochester area, but at any
wow.
one time, the maximum population here now is maybe about 15,000 to 20,000 birds.
Wow.
And we're talking with Michael Kenny from the Minnesota DNR Wildlife. Are we to take from this that this is a sign of a healthy ecosystem or environment, the fact that the population is as it is?
Right, and I think so. They've done quite well, since the rediscovery in 1962. We've done quite a bit of work to try to make their efforts successful with creating refuges where birds are protected, having supplemental food sources, having restrictive hunting seasons, that sort of thing. So. It's all seemed to have paid off.
Is this the flyover area? Like one of those big, like out in western Minnesota,
right,
they have
right.
those big flyways.
Right, and you think about Canada geese too, there are really 11 accepted subspecies or races of Canada goose, the giant being the largest at 12, 13 pounds. All the way to the other end, the cacklers that can be 4 pounds, they're not much bigger than a mallard really. You can see some of those move through this area in the fall. So there's a lot of these different races of geese that nest in different parts of North America, well up into Canada and into Alaska, that might come through Minnesota, and some do come through the Rochester area.
So,
yeah.
Now, there's another set of birds in Rochester that is causing a lot of talk, and that would be the crows. Does the DNR have anything to do with the crows?
Well, we do set seasons on crows.
Can we blame them on you?
No,
well, come on.
No, not necessarily. Okay. I mean, we certainly haven't been doing any work to try to increase the numbers of crows.
Just kidding.
But there are crows in the city, and they've developed a tradition over the last few years of roosting in the city.
Right.
And so there's a heat island effect, basically, with metropolitan areas where temperatures inside a city as large as Rochester can be quite a few degrees warmer than outside the city, especially in the wintertime. They're protected. There's food sources, and so that tradition has developed for crows to feed out in the county, come back to the city at night, and large numbers of them can make kind of a mess of your car. And so that's where a lot of the consternation comes from, is that habit they have of relieving themselves on cars and sidewalks.
There's nothing you can do about it, really.
No. Well, the city has worked in recent years to try to dissipate the numbers of birds through noisemakers and that sort of thing, and try to make it uncomfortable for crows.
All right.
And some of that is working, I think.
All right. Well, yeah. We were comfortable talking with you about it, so that's a good thing. Thanks, right. Michael, very much for joining us.
Welcome. Thank you.
And that'll do it for our program this week. Hey, tell us what's happening in your neighborhood of our town. Drop us a line at rochester@ksmq.org.
Thanks for joining us. See you next time on Our Town.